do it on a computer. Okay, I got it. And then Psalms 41, verse 3. The Lord sustains them on their sick bed and restores them from their bed of illness, which I thought it was just a really good scripture, especially for right now, because there's like a sickness going on like throughout the world. And it's just a blessing that so many people who have been affected by it, that literally like the Lord met them in their homes and literally healed their bodies, and they still have time here. And I don't know, I just feel like that's a huge blessing just to still be here and to be in good health and for the Lord to come and like personally restore your body. So I just thought that was a good scripture to kind of like study, even when you're affected by something, in regards to like health and everything going on with COVID. Did anybody else have anything from Psalms 41?
I got 41 and 11. It says, by this I know that thou favorest me, because thy enemies does not trumpet over me. And then 12, it says, and as for me, thou should uphold me and my integrity, and set it and pretty much sit me before thy face forever. So pretty much like saying, like, you know how people wrong you and you want to see them like get wrong back or something like this. This pretty much like, I think this helped me be like, man, it don't matter like what's going on with them, Lord. The fact that you see me is enough for me. Like that's pretty much where I'm at with it now. And I'm like, pretty much was grateful for that verse to even see that, like, Lord, like, just don't forget about me.
And that's huge. It's like, you kind of let go. Like, you know, yeah. I give you everything and you got me because you see me. Man, God seeing you is huge. Wow, yeah, that's not to be taken lightly. And then, did anybody else have anything from 41? Hey, y'all.
Say, I'm learning the art of having grace and patience with people. Just from where I currently work, a lot of the people that I work with have some, not clients, but actually colleagues, they have some traumas, and I'm seeing it express itself in many different ways. Mm-hmm. And, you know, it's easy to take it. Yeah, I'm on Bible study. I'm trying to talk about the Lord, huh? It's not ready. Goodbye. Nobody want me to get my Bible study on. No, but I do work with a lot of people, and that whatever happened in their childhood, I'm seeing it manifest itself in many different ways amongst each and every one of them. I mean, it's honestly like I'm with 7 people, and 7 people have childhood traumas, and 7 people are dealing with those things. And there's a lot of bickering at times and a lot of fight. And I've been learning the art of graciousness, because you have to extend grace to people when they are dealing with traumas. Some people don't even understand some of their behaviors, them trying to cope with whatever trauma. So that has really been, I've been really tested in that area, just kind of be balanced, not be irritable. You know, like if someone does something, it's easy to be irritated, but then I had to take a step back and say, okay, let's extend grace in this space.
And just to be honest, you actually lead by a really good example for me, just in that in general. I'd be like, wait, what? And you'd be like, yeah, well, this is this. And, you know, and I feel like you have a very mature spirit, like when it comes to grace, and it just like, honestly, it's infectious, because I literally will find myself thinking about you and the way you respond to people, regardless if they say something strange or whatever. You'd be like, I don't know, I feel like you just have a grace for it. And I also think that you're there on purpose, you know what I mean, because you're around a lot of trauma. Mm-hmm. Okay, yeah, you definitely got to stay prayed up before you enter, you know, into the room, and because you know that is, but you're also there to be like the light in a dark place. So the fact that you choose to not be impatient, or not even to just be standoffish, you could kind of be like, hey girl, not today, you know, but the fact that you're still like receiving of them, literally you give them a like pieces of Christ, which they might not get if they're not in relationship with the Lord. But I just want to honestly say, you do such a good example with just showing mercy and grace. And I'm like, okay, she's goals. Like, this is an area where I really want to develop more. Yeah. Yeah. Okay. And then, so for Psalms 42 summary, the psalmist describes his yearning for God. Psalm 42 scriptures that kind of stood out to me. Verse 3, my tears have been my food day and night, while people say to me all day long, where is your God? And that just like really stood out to me, because I feel like when you're like going through the go through sometimes, like you literally, that's how you feel. You're like, man, like, God, I'm going through it right now. Like, you know, where are you? You know, like, look at this. This is a mess. Like my life is like a mess in this area at the moment. And it's to me, it's just really relatable when you go through it. And when people say, well, where is your God? But like, God is faithful. And I know now that you have to go through that, go through where you are like literally crying before you go to bed, crying before, you know, you get up in the morning. But it's like in that I've learned to bless God. Like, yep, I have destruction all around me. Yep. Chaos and all hell has definitely broken loose, Lord, but you are still faithful. You are still with me. I'm going to push through this with you. Those are the days I don't listen to no ratchet music. I'm like, I can only listen to the Lord right now because I am on the edge. And when you start listening to that music, I promise you, you'll be off on like, you get off. I was like, not today. So those are the days you cling to Jesus. Yeah. So that was really relatable. And then the fourth verse, it says, these things I remember as I pour out my soul, how I used to go to the house of God under the protection of the Mighty One with shouts of joy and praise among the festive throng. And I also thought that was good because you do have to reflect on those times when you had joy, when you have peace, and when you're going into church or you're going into worship and you're like, yes, God, you know, and you're on fire for him and he meets you there and you remember his love and his grace, that you literally don't let your pain or whatever it is you're going through isolate you or shut your spirit down when we stop seeking God, which happens so often. And so yeah, remembering, God brought me through that. God brought me through this. You know, he's going to bring me through this situation. Why would he leave me now? And then verse 5, it said, why, my soul, are you downcast? Why so disturbed within me? Put your hope in God, for I will yet praise him, my Savior, my God. And I have another version, which was like my ESV. And it says, why, my soul, are you so dejected? Why are you in such turmoil? Put your hope in God, for I will still praise him, my Savior and my God. So just remembering, like, when your soul, which is your mind, your will, and emotions, start to get you off track and you just start to feel really bad about yourself and bad about the situation that you're going through, you got to remember, I got to put my hope back in God and give him the praise. So those kind of stood out for me because they all represent what the go through looks like for myself. And I'm sure for what y'all have felt at some point when you are going through the go through of it all. Did anybody else have anything from Psalms 42 that stood out to them? No pressure. If not, we can go into Psalms 43. The psalmist asks for salvation and he expresses his devotion to God. And the scripture that stood out to me from Psalms 43, which was super short, super, super short. And I kind of feel like they really get caught up in their feelings. Like, I feel like that's like a theme throughout Psalms where they are like really just sorrowful, really oppressed, really ashamed, and just really feel so undeserving of God's love. Like a lot through Psalms, I noticed that. But Psalms 43 verse 1, it says, vindicate me, my God, and plead my cause against an unfaithful nation. Rescue me from those who are deceitful and wicked. And another translation was, vindicate me, God, and champion my cause against an unfaithful nation. Rescue me from the deceitful and unjust person. And I just love that. Champion my cause against the unfaithful nation. Like, Lord, let me come out of this like on top. Despite the people who are deceitful and unjust and want to see me fall, like, God, you're going to vindicate me despite all of that. And that scripture was just, I only had that one, but I thought it was powerful enough that I was like, okay, it can sustain itself. That's a good scripture. Did anybody have anything from 53? I know it's kind of small. Read.
It's cold outside.
It is cold.
Commute me if you need to. Okay. I'm not able to mute myself.
You're all right. So then, okay, nobody else has anything from Psalms 44, which is the summary is the psalmist describes God's past deeds and asks for a military victory. And then Psalms 44 scriptures that kind of stood out was Psalms 44, verse 2. With your hands, you drove out the nations and planted our ancestors. You crushed the peoples and made our ancestors flourish. And one more translation that I did, because I kind of been liking to go between more than one to make sure I really understand. And it just says, in order to plant them, you displaced the nations by your hand in order to settle them. So what do you guys think about that scripture? Like, from your takeaway with Psalms 44, verse 2, with your hands, you drove out the nations and planted our ancestors. Does that mean just as you did before us with our ancestors, you'll go ahead of us and, like, protect us and give us the same, like, reign or, I don't know, power that he gave those before us? Like, is that what you guys got from it? Or... because our ancestors flourished, you know, even though they were oppressed. And I kind of feel like right now we have oppression around us, but I still feel like God is going to have us to flourish. Like he kind of, he went before us, then he goes before us now. That was my takeaway. I don't know if you guys had anything different. And then for verse 3, it says, it was not by their sword that they won the land, nor did their arm bring the victory. It was your right hand, your arm, and the light of your face, for you love them. And I thought that was just a grateful reminder of God's faithfulness in times of battle, that we will have the victory, and it will not be because we were so good. It will not be because we did everything right. It will literally be because God won the victory and did it for us. So that was a good reminder, because that's what he does for those that he loves. And then Psalms 44, verse 23. Awake, Lord, why do you sleep? Rouse yourself, do not reject us forever. And I really just highlighted that scripture just because I feel like we oftentimes think that God is asleep on us or not paying attention. But in all honesty, God always sees us, and he always is watching over us, and he doesn't reject us. I just feel like sometimes our feelings kind of put us in that place where we're just like, God is here, I'm going through it, he's not with me. And it's not true, but sometimes I feel like your feelings can literally, like, start to lie to you. Like, I'll literally be like lying to myself about things, and I'm like,
it's kind of like when people say, it's like some kind of saying, your emergency is not my emergency. Mm-hmm. So like, we're always in a, like, you don't like, I don't like being uncomfortable, I personally don't. And so when you're in the midst of something, you just want it to be over. And I guess, like, in the midst of it is where you really get the value, really get the meat out of everything. And so we're always in a rush. And I think it's us trying to get out of it feeling like, hello, do you see me up over here? I'm in it. You can come on now. And it's more like, no, it's not, you're not ready to come out of it. What you're ready to do is keep walking through it. And yeah. I think we just look at that.
Yeah, that's good. To say that your emergency is not my emergency is, it's so funny because I feel like, That's how God is too. And because sometimes we automatically go into emergency panic mode, and the Lord is like, girl, don't you know I got you? Yes, hey. That's the way to put it. And hey, and Psalms, okay, so that was Psalms 44, verse 23. Did anybody else have anything from Psalms 44 that stood out to them?
I just want to say, I was just thinking of Paris, and then she just popped in.
Seriously?
Yes, like,
ooh, okay, that's
right after I thought. I was like, oh, I wonder where Paris is.
That is so, I don't even think we can hear you. Paris.
Hi.
Do you know Raquel just, like, got on here and said she literally just thought about you, and as soon as she thought about you, you popped up on the screen. What are you doing?
What are you doing, Raquel?
So, okay. Did I actually turn the page? Did I read from the wrong spot? Lord, child, I don't know what I just did. My Bible page moved. Okay, so for Psalms, did anybody else have anything for Psalms 44 or no? This stood out? No? Okay. Psalms 45 summary. The psalmist praises a bride and groom and encourages them to act appropriately is the theme. And the scriptures that stood out to me was Psalms 45, verse 4. And it says, in your majesty, ride forth victoriously in the cause of truth, humility, and justice. Let your right hand achieve awesome deeds. I thought that was a really beautiful scripture. And then I had another translation of it, which was, in your splendor, ride triumphantly in the cause of truth, humility, and justice. So I just thought that that was a good way of remembering how to live like a victorious life. Let your right hand achieve awesome deeds. And just to stay focused on truth, humility, and justice is a great way to grow and a great place to sit in. And another one that stood out was Psalms 45, verse 7. It says, you love righteousness and hate wickedness. Therefore, God, your God, has set you above your companions by anointing you with the oil of joy. And I thought that was really good because I can literally see people who are like rooted in Christ. I'm drawn to them because I can like feel their joy. And I know it's not just joy based off like monetary things or everything they got going. You're like, man, it's something about that person. I'm like drawn to them. And that's literally like the joy of the Lord is in them. And and it's nothing but God. And I just thought that was a great reminder that He has set you above your companions by anointing you with the oil of joy. I'm grateful for the oil of joy. And I'm grateful that the oil of joy is over our lives and that we are the righteous. So I just thought that that was a great reminder of who we really are. And because we know who we are, that's a part of what we carry.
Amen.
Because, you know, sometimes people will say, I don't like her or something, or I don't like him or what, I don't know what it is. You know, he just do too much or, you know, he just got a big personality. A good way people are going to have a hard time receiving you. I feel like they just do too much or he just do too much. But sometimes they might really be feeling, I don't even know, like, what it is about your light.
And that's what it means. They don't know. It's the unknown. You have to be that happy all the time. Like, something is phony about it. Like, I had somebody tell Jeff, like, is she like that all the time? Like, she just seems like she's too good to be true. He was like, nah, she ain't no angel. He said, but for the most part, I mean, she love life. And that's because I'm at the part of my life, I ain't got to explain nothing to you. Either you want to know what got me and what drive me to this point where I can wake up every day in life being a human and can feel this way. It's God. Every day I wake up, he gives me a chance to start over, to get it right, to get it act right. And if he can be that merciful for me, I can get up every day and I can strive to be the best I can be. And knowing that I have him in my corner, I say in my church, and you all might hear the saints say it, I'd rather have God than don't need him, don't have him. And that's how I feel. God gives me joy. He makes me happy. I don't need monetary. I always tell people that's around me and surround me, I would take blessings over monetary every day and any day, because any fool knows that if God blessing you, monetary is added in there. I don't do what I do for God for monetary. I do what I do for God because I want to have a seat in his house. I want to sit at his table one day. I know my life down here, it would not be everlasting, but I know up there to be everlasting. So if I can live right down here to get up there, then that's what I'm gonna have to do. I don't have time to keep explaining to people. You know, you have people that don't want to believe in God. You know, I say what I say and keep it moving. I'm not gonna argue with you about God. We ain't gonna debate. But if you don't know him, I pity the fool, like Mr. T used to say.
Yes, absolutely. That's a good way to put it. And I'm gonna pray, you know, that you won't stay in a foolish place. That was good. So yeah, we read 7. One more that I had that was good was Psalms 45 verse 17, which was the last one. As I read through it, I saw like different things that was discussed, like about daughters, pay attention, consider, forget your people and your father's house, and the king will desire your beauty. And he kind of talks to like his daughters about what they should be doing, and then like sons, your sons will succeed, your ancestors, you will make them princes throughout the land. And he's talking about all the different things that he's going to do through his daughters and through his sons. And then at the very end, it said, I will cause your name to be remembered for all generations. Therefore, the people will praise you forever and ever. And I just thought that that's wonderful, because that's exactly who God is. Like, we were studying the Bible that was written so long ago, but we still give his name praise for generations to come. So I just thought it was a powerful scripture. I actually had one more translation of it too. And it just said, I will perpetuate your memory through all generations. Therefore, the nations will praise you forever and ever. And he's worthy. So I thought it was a beautiful scripture. Did anybody else have anything from 45 that stood out to them? If not, it's okay. So a little backdrop about our discussion. I went to go get my hair done. And the lady who does my hair, and I'm just going to give a short little backdrop on what happened. She does my hair. She's prophetic. I know that she's prophetic. I sat down right before we started. And let me try to think of how to package this. She basically says things to me that no one would know about me. And she started, I'm trying to be honest, but I have to also consider the fact that everyone watches this. So she starts to tell me things about myself that I know that no one else would know. And she says in so many words, Christina, she says you have to start your healing process. And I was like, okay, when she was so spot on to the point where I could not speak. I couldn't move. I couldn't speak. She said, you have to start your healing process in this area of rejection and the area of unresolved, maybe pain, that you just never dealt with it from feeling rejected from this. And I need you to know, God needs you to know that he really, really loves you. And then he trusts you with, she didn't even know about my Bible study, y'all. I could literally cry thinking about it. She said, he trusts you with this area and he sent you the right women, but you have to make sure you get yourself whole so that you don't bleed on the women he's called you to.
Amen. Huh? Cause it can happen.
It can happen.
I'm going to book my appointment tomorrow because she is truth.
He is truth. So I'm sitting here and she was saying so many detailed things about my family. Like she didn't say by name, but she said by who, she said what it was. And I couldn't lie. I couldn't fight it. I couldn't hide it. I just received everything she said. She said, you must go through this process. You must start this process. And it was actually so simultaneously, I guess both things were happening because this is in the spirit. And then I have my therapist. I told you I started with my therapy. And she said, well, you come back next week. We're going to uncover some layers. And I told her, I said, oh, I really am not looking forward to that. And she said, well, you know, this is a part of what it is. That's the only way you, I said, what happens when you uncover layers? And she said, that's when you start to heal.
Yeah. Yeah. Okay. That's that's right. When you cut yourself, when you hurt yourself as a kid, you see them layers healing.
I said, you're right. So I said, all right. I was like, so I have to go through this process. I feel very exposed. I feel very vulnerable. I feel very uncomfortable, honestly. And what she told me was, and I kept praying. I said, I don't know if this is what we're supposed to talk about in Bible study. She said, pray about it before you say it, because it needs to be God and not me. And I heard it three more times after I talked to her. So I know this was where I was supposed to go. And it says, don't shortcut the process. There are no shortcuts for the process. And I was like, all right, Lord. So I studied into that. I pushed into that. The process will produce four things. It will first prepare your identity. It will prepare your identity. The second thing, it will prepare your perseverance. The third thing the process prepares is your character. And the fourth thing that the process prepares is your hope. You cannot shortcut the process of sitting and waiting for God to say what the next door will be. You cannot be waiting for promotion without first letting God privately prune you. There are no ways around going through the process of clearing out, in a way, like I felt like clearing out your spirit from the things, the debris, the things that have been left behind that have kept you stagnant. There's no way around this process. And it's ugly sometimes and it doesn't feel that good. So what I wanted to ask you guys in support, because I don't feel that I'm like super there yet, but just as a community, how are you guys handling your process? Like, how are you handling wanting to see yourself as Z and you're still kind of at M? Or how are you handling like wanting to do ministry, but you're not fully whole and, you know, in certain areas that you know God is calling you to get whole in? Like, how are any of you guys handling your process? And I'll answer first. And I just felt like for me, handling my process looked bigger than just me in this season. I couldn't just consult with myself. It looked like I needed to get therapy. It looked like I needed to have maybe a spiritual advisor. And it looked like more prayer time and time alone with God than ever before, because I cannot do this on my own. Like, it's not even like in me. So I'm super vulnerable, a little bit emotional, and I'm really pushing into God in a new, fresh way. So where are y'all? How are y'all handling this process?
With myself, I'm all over the place with it. I'm not going to even lie. You know, I'm still grasping, trying to figure out what God will have me do as far as with myself. You know, I've been in the process of taking care of people for so long to sometimes when I think that I'm free to do me, it falls back on where as though I feel as though I'm a ball of yarn unraveling out of control. It's, you know, it's like I never can stay in the lane where I have to do me. I don't know if it's because it's my heart and I love a lot, you know. It's like with my family, it's a double curse. It's like sometimes I feel like I can never do me or even get in the position where God want me to be. And I hear him saying, pray more, go into seclusion. I've been doing that. I've heard him say, okay, come to me. I've done that. You know, I need you to fast. I've done that. You know, cut yourself off from people. I've done that. But I still keep running back into the situation where as though I can't get to him and just be me and him 101, because it's always something interrupting. I gotta continue to pray, because I really don't. Today I had such a problem with, in this blizzard, I wanted to drive to the west side of Chicago to see about my little sister. So I'm trying to figure out, like, how do I stop being like this ball of yarn for them? You know, it's like every time I'm in a place and I'm comfortable with me, I tend to let my family pull me back in. And I know it's God want me to be able to love them and stand in the gap for them. But it just seemed like I feel like you're not standing the gap for yourself, you know? And even if you're sick and you shut in, you still got a mind and you got a tongue to pray. I feel like they're not praying. And I feel like, you know, if I'm going to stop what I'm doing to come and see about you, I feel like if you were praying and you had a relationship with God, then I wouldn't have to come, because you will have him. So again, I'm all over the place. I really can't even answer that question. The more I try to answer it, it gets further away from me. I really don't know. And it's maybe that's something I need to work on, because I'm serious. I just had a conversation with my husband. He was like, I don't think that's a good idea. For one, it's messy outside. For two, why are you going to put yourself in a predicament? It's dangerous out here, you know? So I don't want that to cause problems with us. But then again, here you go again, where I don't know what to do when it comes to certain things. I really don't. I might be able to tell you what to do and the next person what to do, but sometimes I really drop the ball on myself, and I'm just tired of that. I really am. I'm so frustrated with myself at times. Like, you can't keep doing this, because you at the door, you at the gate. God then gave you the key. You done left it in the car, you know? So
y'all pray for me. That I wanted to say, because I saw Jonna had asked a question too, but really we were just talking about, how are you dealing with your process? Like, there's no shortcuts to going through the process, whether that be cleaning yourself up, some dirt, debris, things like that, waiting for God to answer your prayer, whatever it might be. Like, what I told them, I had kind of like an experience with someone who told me, a prophet who was talking to me about an area that I know that no one would know. And she was like, you have to literally start your healing process so that God can get you from A to Z, you know? And not that I'll be perfect, but just starting your process. So my question to everyone was, what does that look like? And what I thought Paris said that was really good, she's like, you know, I really just don't know. And one revelation that came to my mind that my therapist gave me last week, and I'm not sure if this would sit with you well, but she asked me, why do you, because basically some of my worth, and that's just we talk about different things, but she said some of your worth is caught up in acts of service, the way you care for other people, the things you do, the way you keep your home. And when those things are not done, it's almost like you have a hard time, like you're not being a good wife, or you're not being a good daughter, you're not being a good housekeeper. And with certain situations and relationships in my life, I pulled back in certain ways, and with a lot of different people in this season. And I told her, I really actually feel very bad about it, mm-hmm. because I don't want to ever feel like I just was being selfish. I just didn't have time. Cause you know, when it comes to things that are important, I do want to be there, but there's also those seasons where you just say, I don't have it. Like, I just don't have it. And figuring out what not having it looks like and doing it in love. And she said, I want you to really take some time to figure out, if you're not being of service to people, why that makes you feel like not a good person, why that makes you so frustrated with yourself sometimes. And she said, it's okay to take time for yourself. You're human. She said, it's like necessary. To have a good life, you have to have those boundaries. You have to have those things. You have to have your time where you're like, you know what, right now I can't talk. Right now, it sounds bad to say I'm doing me, but I need to take some time for myself and stop making it like you're a bad person, or you're being selfish, or you not giving enough, or you not being like as of service enough. It's like, no, sometimes things have to be done in moderation. And she kind of just challenged me to figure out what my boundaries look like and come back when the Lord tells me to come back. But as for right now, like, hey, like, I can't make that drive out there to do this for you today. I'm praying for you. You know, I want this to change. I'm here if you really need me, but I can't do that today. And that'll make you no less. That'll make you a bad sister. You just couldn't do it. You've done a lot, of other things. So yeah, I don't know. That was something. Did anybody else have anything as far as like their process?
And the training. Well, for my process is Bible study. This Bible study, okay. It's church, it's praying more, fasting, living in my truth, and just accepting things for exactly what it is, like not kind of like I don't know how to put it, like. You know how you have your perspective of something and then like you like be naive about certain things.
Uh-huh.
So now that I'm out of certain situations, like I can look back and see like you knew better. Like talking to myself, living in my truth and holding myself accountable is some of the things that I've been doing. And so when I was in this training and when Perry said that she starts to feel bad, when she wants to do me. So you gotta look at it like this, right? When you're on the airplane and they go over the rules, what do they say? What do they say first? Who do you save first?
Yourself, put the mask on yourself.
You gotta save you. Because if you dead, then hey, the airplane, like, it's over with. So if you put your mask on, then you can get up and you can help other people. So you were saying that you was like, and I feel like both of y'all said, like, I feel bad. I don't feel bad. Like, no. Like, you're wearing me thin. And so, like, when I'm not here, then you just use the next person and I will be nothing to you. So, no, I'm sorry, but I can't do it. And I'm not even sorry about it. I'm just trying to be, like, they said to have a little grace, but like, I'm not sorry about it. Not in this season. Like, man, I'm going through way too much to be having other people stretch me thin. Like, nah, no, thank you.
No, thank you.
Hey, it's Sakina. I was going to say, Tina, I don't know where you are in the books. I don't want to spoil it for you.
No, good. go ahead, because I've been reading. Go ahead.
Okay. I literally, I'm sorry if I'm a little winded, because I literally had to like run downstairs and find this book. So I was like, oh my gosh. Week four, is the name of the book is called The Holy Ghost in Me. It's a 30-day devotional with the Creator, the Son, and the Holy Spirit. And it's by another girlfriend's cousin, I think. Her name is Joy Simeon. Mm-hmm. And this book is like, she comes for me every day. Let me just say that every day. One thing I want to say before I forget it, because Tina, when you were talking about like needing to heal, I realized, I think this was like week two or week three, she talked about, one of the topics was, what are you afraid of? And she talked about fear. And I realized that I have a fear of being great. So I have so much like skills and capabilities and everything to just like be exceedingly so. And I don't know what it is about me per se, but like I feel content, but then I get a discontentment in what I am and like my situation. And after reading this, like the Lord literally had to like kick me. Like I'm having a lot of issues with work. I'm looking to move on, but he had to just kick me and was just like, you know, literally like your discontentment with work is because truthfully, this is not the path you were supposed to be. You were supposed to be greater. And I let things sidetrack me from that greatness. So in here, she talked about fear and she said, fear is just one way the devil tries to control you. And if you do not watch it, fear can control your entire life and your thought process, hindering you from reaching your destiny. To truly walk in maturity, you need to conduct an emotional inventory and unpack the areas of your life that increase your worries and your anxieties. So naturally I thought of you. and you know, fear can scare you into disobedience, where you stop doing what God called you to do. Which when I read it, when I was going through it, it hit me because it was like, I allowed things to sway me from that path of greatness because I thought it was okay. And I don't even know if I can entirely call it disobedience. I just allowed the distractions, which ultimately by virtue of it being a distraction, played its way into a disobedience. But in terms of the process, the lesson this week, I can't remember if it was Tuesday or Wednesday of this week, but the lesson this week said, it was about stop telling God what you're ready for. And it just the quick backdrop says, stop telling God that you are ready for the promise to arrive. God knows the right time and season to deliver the promise. If the promise is slow in coming, that means you are not ready for the promise and the promise is not ready for you. Do not grow weary. Keep praying and praising. Know that God is a promise keeper. And I have found he's checked me this week because I'm having like so much angst about like the next move and the promises that have been told to me and everything, that I've been caught up in this rut of complaining. And he really had to check me. And like I said, she comes for me every week. When I realized I was caught in a rut of complaining, I kid you not, the devotional for that day said, did you know whining and complaining slows down the arrival speed of your promise? The key to any waiting season is to wait with a purpose. So I say all that, just like getting to the main line that I wanted to say was, she talked about the process and she was saying that like, there's lessons to be learned in the process that will prepare you for greater, for your promise. And that we know that he's a promise keeper. And so we tend to grasp onto the promise keeping, but we tend to forget that in the promise keeping, he's still our father. And he still nurtures us, right? So even though it's like in a sense of a parent, like I'm gonna give you this if you, once you get here, but along the way, I'm still gonna raise you. I'm still gonna discipline you. I'm still gonna teach you and I'm still gonna provide for you. So in that, like getting to the, through that process, allowing him to teach us what we need to teach and realizing for me in the sense of like having this fear of greatness, realizing for me that like I'm pushing past the process, past the teachings, because I just want to get to the promise. And I'm letting other distractions create my hindrance. Mm. And in doing that, like he'll bring me to that promise, but then I get so far, so caught up in like, I just got to get to the promise. I know he's a great guy. I just got to get to it. And then I miss all the lessons that I needed to learn along the way, which causes me to ultimately have to repeat them. And then I get frustrated, or then I get sidetracked. And it's like, he's still my father, my unconditionally loving father. He's trying to teach me and raise me along the way so that when I come to that promise, you know, it's a full contentment. I don't have to worry about a discontentment. So I guess bringing it all together.
That was good. That was a really good, I think the devotion went really well, like with like kind of what we spoke about. And like you said, that process, because then we go back to the four steps. During the process, God prepares your identity. He prepares your perseverance. He prepares your character, and he prepares hope. But like, if it comes too soon, you literally will lose it. Like, you know, it's like, God knows the timing of it all. So I'm like, okay, Lord, the posture of how I'm going to wait and start my work is going to be just at your feet. Like, I'm not going to complain about it no more. I'm not going to excuse it no more. Oh, I pop off from time to time because that's just how we roll sometimes in our family, you know, versus saying, you know what, let me be the one to start to do something differently. Let me do my work. So that was really great. Does anybody else have anything for how they are handling the process?
I wouldn't say that I'm handling it well, but I'll talk a little bit about, okay. I think that I guess I'm in that stage where the Lord is dealing with my character, like how I deal with disappointment. So, you know, he's called me to some things, and some things I feel like I've tried to do and then they didn't turn out well. And he's like, okay, I didn't change my mind about that. You still need to do it. And I've just been like, yeah, but I don't want to try it anymore because I don't want to, you know, fail. Like, I don't really like failures. So I think he's trying to get me to help me understand like the lessons in like failure, you know, and how you can't succeed without like trying something. And even if you fall, like he has to catch us, you know, so it's not like you're going to fall and like bottom out. But for me, it's like, I don't even want to take the risk anymore. And then so it's like a stagnation. So I feel like we're at this stage where he's like, yep, you've got all the instruction you need. Like, you don't need another prophetic word. You need to move, and you need to get beyond the disappointment of like things not working out before, and still trust that, you know, I've still called you to these things. And so the way that I've been trying to deal with that process, I've just been trying to really surrender to like where I am right now. Like, I'm not where I want to be. I'm not, don't, you know, I haven't gotten to where I want to go, but like, I am where I am, right? And so like, in this place, there are lessons. Like, in this place, there is instruction. In this place, like, there's a stretching that's very, very uncomfortable. But the more I resist it, you know, the longer I'll be here. Like, that's what I do know. So I'm trying not to resist and just like to surrender to this moment, and then to make myself move. Like, I just like, okay, if you're telling me to finish this book, like, I can write for 20 minutes a day. Like, you know what I mean? Like, I can't make any excuse. Like, as busy as I am, everybody's got 20 minutes a day to do what God called them to do. So, you know, like, trying to hold myself accountable in that way, and really just surrender to the moment. Like, nothing is going to change until I start moving. So yeah.
Yeah. And also like applying some of those scriptures to literally, you know, exactly what God told you to do. You know, it's not going to fail. It's going to be successful because God told you to do it. Anything I feel like God told you to do, regardless if you wrote the book and one person bought it and then they tell a person and the next person buys it, like, that person got what they needed in it. So like, don't be so hard on yourself either with, you know, it not going exactly the way you saw it going the first time. The second time you do it rooted in Christ, you do it without so much fear, and don't beat yourself up as much. You'll be surprised how God will bless that. It'll have like an anointing on it where it literally would just flourish because you did it with the right heart posture. So we came on a little late with Cindy. Do you think you have anything, not to put you on the spot, but I know we have like a few minutes and you have a lot of wisdom and insight, I would say, when you're going through the process of healing, let's say you're going through the process of healing, or you're going through a process where God has you wait, you're ready to get out of the season, and he's like, no, you're not ready. And you see everyone else around you moving, you're tired of waiting, you're ready for a shift. What is something you can do like throughout that process to sustain yourself?
Hi, everybody. Hey. Yeah. just in a nutshell, real quick, I want to address the young lady that just spoke The first thing I heard you say, what jumped in my heart, is there is no failure in Christ. We don't fail. We learn. Failure is defined as you going off on your own. And that isn't even failure, because it's God allowed it. So if he's allowing it, he's allowing it for a reason. Because if it's something really, really bad, he'll put his hand up and stop you in your place. So it's not, don't be, ever be afraid to fail. Always be concerned with not moving. This is life. It's never going to be right. It's never going to be a perfect time. It's never going to be where all your eggs are in the basket, where all your ducks are in a row. Life is messy. And as soon as you get, Reverend Wright used to say, you have three stages of your life. You're either going into a storm, you're in the middle of a storm, or you're coming out of a storm. And that may sound really harsh, but it's very true. Because sometimes you don't even know you're in the middle of the storm because you're in the eye of the storm and it's real calm. So as soon as we get to a certain place in our walk where we accept this is it, stop looking for this great thing or this great time or this great season. Because even in the great seasons when everything seems to be going well, there's going to be something. That's just how we grow. That's the process. You're like that until you die. Even on your deathbed, you know, I've watched, including my mother, very loving, good people suffer. And you're like, what is going on with this guy? Just take him home. But there's a process in that. There's a process for the person that is going through the suffering. And then there's a process for those that have been called to care for that person that are suffering. So as long as you are on this earth, it's gonna be some fun. Jesus told you flat out, you're gonna go through it, but when you go through it, you won't be drowned. You won't be taken over, you'll have peace. But if you get that ideal out of your mind, your jumping off place of success or failure or any judgment thereof, it's gonna take away a lot of that pressure, a lot of that stress, a lot of that imagining of where you should be, where you want to be, where you're supposed to be, even where you shouldn't be. So it took me a long time, and I'm not saying I perfected that, but just to get in that place of one of the things we talked about, some of you all were here this summer, when I found out my favorite disciple was Nathaniel, and it's why, because Nathaniel didn't do nothing. He didn't do nothing. Jesus saw him sitting under a tree and said, you're a Hebrew amongst Hebrews. And he even got smart with Jesus. Who are you? You from Nazareth. But what he was doing was spending time and meditating with God. He wasn't doing for God. He was just being with God. And that's a hard thing, because we're taught the exact opposite. Achieve, achieve, achieve. Be disciples. Go out. Win the kingdom. Run your household. Be a good wife. Be a good mother. Be a good Christian. Be a good church goer. Everything you're supposed to be. And that's not God's ultimate desire. We were created to be in fellowship with him in the garden. That's what we were created for. We weren't created to work. So sometimes we have to find our way back to that place for our original purpose and creation, to just be with God. And that's hard to do, especially for Black women. We have this huge monkey on our back to be the best against all odds. And that's really not how God judges us. His pleasure with us is just being with him. How do you do that? I got to go to work. I got kids. I have responsibilities. I've got things you told me to do. How do you be? What does that look like? You got to figure that out.
Yeah.
You got to figure that out.
Yeah, that's good. Yeah. That's really good. Well, that's incredible. Okay, wow, I need to let that sit with me. Paige, were you gonna say something? Ooh, all right.
You had to take Paige off mute.
Background noise. It was getting real.
I told you this while over here. And you know my internet beat, it was doing good for a while. Now it didn't stop. I can't do nothing. I will say in my process, I don't know where I am. I know that I'm running. Maybe that's where I'm at. I'm running. I'm always on the go. And a part of me is trying to just keep the balls in the air. That's where I'm at. I'm trying to keep the balls in the air, and I don't know if I'm keeping them all. Hope some of them haven't dropped, and I don't know. But that's what I'm doing. I'm literally running every day. And it's like, it's kind of like I can feel that I'm almost there. Like, I don't know where there is, but I have this feeling that I'm almost there. So that gave me a second wind. Like, I have to keep running because there's something that's telling me I'm almost there. And I don't know where there is. I don't know where I'm almost at, but that's where I'm at, where I just feel this, like, I have to keep going. I have to keep going. There's times where I just wish people were like, oh, if they cancel on me, I'm just close my schedule out, and they don't. And so then I'm tired, but I just keep going because I feel it. Like, I'm in this place where I can just feel that I'm supposed to keep going. And so I just keep going, keep going, keep going, keep going. And just trying to keep the balls in the air and just double checking, triple checking, quadruple checking. So that's where I'm at. Like, just like this. I feel like I'm like this, a hamster.
Where does that leave you? Because I feel like even if you feel like, okay, you have peace in the sense where, okay, God is saying you're on the right track, I want you to keep pushing towards something, but within balance. Like, maybe if you say, like, maybe I'll do this like one day a week, or if I'm going to end, you know, a little bit earlier than before. Because to me, mentally, it's a lot to always be thinking about what's the next ball to catch.
Yeah.
Because when you're always like, whoa, what's next? What's next? It almost makes you like not normal, like not in the moment anymore. It's like it makes me feel very anxious. And to the point where I had to tell Tarion, like, he was talking to me when I was out with him. He was like, okay, let's go here, let's go there, let's go here. And I literally said, I'm still in Puerto Rico. He was like, what are you talking about? I said, my mind, how we stopped to enjoy our life and we weren't rushing to the next thing. I said, I have to find parts of being on vacation here in this real life so that I don't be crazy. Like, yeah. You have to like kind of tell people sometimes or find a way to scale back and say, I need these moments to myself. Cause like keeping a lot of balls in the air is just a lot.
Yeah, it is. And it's like, I have been trying to find a moment where, cause like my mind races so much, like there's so much things I need. I always feel like there's so many things I need to do. I forgot to do this. I should be doing this. So then what I do is I'll stop and just like, okay, Paige, you have to calm down and sit down for a moment. So I'll sit for a moment. And then I have to hop right back up and I'm going to go again. Because I can't even feel, it's like this fire where you feel like if you could just push it just the needle a little bit further, and I just keep going, keep going, keep going. So that's where I'm at. I don't know what I'm trying to do. I'm trying to do something.
Scale back or find some peace. Like maybe if you sat still, maybe there's something you're not wanting to fully deal with that maybe if you sat still, you might have to deal with. Like maybe with your time of God or maybe with your time of yourself. Like maybe you have to.
Yeah.
Stop and be like, all right, Lord, I'm on the run. Like
it could be that. Like, I don't know.
Paige, faithful Virgo friend, mother, I'ma say, I hear a lot of my younger self in that. I feel like what I had to learn, I was earning it. I was always gonna have the cleanest house and the best room mother at school and the best wife and the best outfit and the best, like, it was my responsibility. You know, I had to be the best. It had to be done. You know, everybody's stuff had to be matching and, you know, you had to be in tutoring and these were my responsibilities. So you never caught me without a to-do list.
Yeah.
And what the Holy Spirit showed me is I didn't know how to live by grace. Does that mean you don't plan and do your work? No. It means I heard a lot of I. And what we have to whittle ourselves down to is, Lord, you. Because then we're not in charge, so we don't get the glory if it goes great, or we don't get the blame if it doesn't. We just surrender. Surrender is a hard thing because it's cult. We've been taught the exact opposite. So you have to learn, and I don't even know how to tell you how to do it except to ask God. There's a scripture that says he is all the while effectually at work in me, energizing and creating in me both the will and the work for his good pleasure, satisfaction, and delight. When I finally just got gritty with God, I can't do this. I don't even know what I'm doing. I don't even know what I'm not doing, but you do. So I'm gonna sit here and I'm gonna stay pray the scripture day in and day out till you do something different in me. And it just slowly starts evolving.
I think
you don't have to be perfect.
I think we can't surrender because it feels like giving up.
Yeah, like I'm standing still, like not doing something, like
just give up.
So but you're not giving up, you're giving in.
Yeah, that's the thing that we don't grasp. Like, okay, like, I'm not giving up, but is your will not mine? Your way not mine? Like, that's hard. It is. When you said
it,
yes.
Even Jesus struggled with that. Think about it. He was like, well, wait a minute. There's a way for me to get out of
here. Take this cup, please.
All I know is. But if he came back himself, not my will, but your will. And think about that. It's harder to surrender to doing things what you think should be done. It's harder to not do something than it is to do something. Think how crazy that sounds. I'm struggling. It's hard. I can't do it done. I'm working myself to death. It's not working out. Then just stop. But I can't stop. If you really, really think about it, it is the enemy's bizarre way of tricking us into not just being with God, separating us from his grace, that we have to be doing something for him, not just being with him. Nobody on their deathbed says, well, I wish my walls would have been painted where the head kids had fingerprints on them. Oh, I wish that I would have got those things in the work or the earlier. That's not what matters. How did I represent God? I represented him in my finest because I spent most time with him. As Paige, I'm listening, you sound so much like grandma, I want to fall out the chair. That's because you spent so much time with her. You start sounding like and acting like the ones who you spend time with. You become what you behold. So if you don't do anything, your 30 minutes of devotion, your write out your journal, everything, but just, I'm just going to sit here and stare at the wall and listen to you, God. And yeah, sometimes my thoughts might drift, but you know, I'll just say my prayer. And if you pray in the spirit, pray in the spirit. It works. It's just being with him. It will make you look like him. So the things that took you 15 hours a day will start taking you 3, and you'll not be able to figure out how did this happen. Because you start operating like the one you're beholding. So you become like him.
Ooh.
People won't even be able. I remember one time they told me, Pastor, she was principal of the school. And I love this story because if everybody in this car has probably been there, it's not the problem of being there, it's the problem of staying there. Where the principal is talking to teachers, and if you know, teachers are notorious for being rude in meetings, and they're being rude and they're talking over the principal. And afterwards, one of the teachers comes up to the principal, is like, how can you stand this? How do you tolerate how they act? She's like, what? She's like, she said, oh girl, I'm so full of the spirit. I'm so above it, I don't even notice. I was like, ooh, that's how I want to live my life. I want to be above it. But that's a choice.
Yeah.
That's a choice. Yeah, so. Okay, Raquel made me sign in. She made me feel guilty. And today I had my hair combed. So.
Donna, would you pray? Would you pray out, Donna? Or you want me to pray out?
Are you talking to me?
Yeah.
Okay. I'm sorry. I didn't hear you. Hallelujah. Father God, we thank you, Lord, this time together. We thank you, God, for your word. We thank you for the discussion. And we just thank you, Lord, that you are here with us, God, that you have promised us that you'll never leave us or forsake us. We thank you for the wisdom that has been shared amongst this group of women, Father. And we just ask you to add to it and increase it. You said if any man lacks wisdom to come to you and that you will give it liberally. So we just ask you, Lord, for more wisdom to get through our week. We ask you, Father God, to give us, enlighten us on the process that you have us in. Father God, we ask you, Lord, to just give us a revelation of where we are and where you're taking us to. We ask you, Lord, to strengthen us. We ask you just to be present. Just to be present and just give us a greater revelation of rest and what it means to really rest in your presence and rest in your glory. And we just thank you, Lord, that we can do all things through Christ who strengthens us. So we thank you, Lord, that the things that you have called us to, you will empower us to finish it. He who began a good work in us will see it through. Yeah. So I thank you, Lord, that we can rest in just the assurance that you've given us in your word, that we are going to the other side. Hallelujah. So I just thank you for all of my sisters, and I just pray for God that you will release what each of them need individually. And I thank you, Lord, that your word will be a light to our feet and a lamp to our path. So I just pray that the word that we've studied and talked about today will continue to guide us. And Holy Spirit, we just depend on you to be our guide and to be our compass. You know the way. You know the way around each corner. You know what awaits us. And so we just ask you to lead us and to guide us. And I just pray, I don't know, I keep seeing your name, Kina. So I just pray whatever is on your heart for Sakina, Lord, I thank you, Lord, that you remind her, God, that you love her, that you remind her, Father God, that she is precious to you, and that you remind her that your promises are yes and amen. So God, we just come into agreement with your promises for Sakina, and we just thank you, Father God, that no weapon formed against her shall prosper. Yes. And we just cast down every imagination that tries to exalt itself over the knowledge of Christ. And so only what you said about her and your plans for her are true. We thank you, Lord, that you have told her to be strong in the Lord and the power of his might. And we thank you, Lord, that you call her into courage and you call her into boldness. I thank you, Father God, that you have already opened the doors that she needs to walk through. And I thank you, Lord, that as she comes to you and she surrenders anxiety at her feet, because you told us to be anxious for nothing, that you're going to take on her burdens and take on her worries, Lord, and exchange peace, hallelujah, and exchange strategy, Lord. We just call forth the strategy of heaven, God, for her to walk through every door that you've called her to. We thank you, Father, for the increase in her life. We thank you, Father God, for an increase, Lord, of an anointing, an increase, God, in the glory of God, even as she sits before you, Lord, that you will just increase her. I just see, Sakina, there's a great call on your life to be like not just an intercessor for people, but really like a living epistle. And I just see like your life being like a book that people read and they will understand the glory of God. So the Lord is calling you into just submission with the things that he's called you to, because it's not just for you and your children, though they will be blessed by it, but they're the onlookers, the readers of the book of your life will be blessed and come into just real awareness of like how God can take just a submission, what God can do with a submitted heart. So Lord, we thank you that you continue to make her an exemplar of what you can do with a submitted heart. And those who will surrender your way and surrender to your way, Father God, you have great in store for her. For your word says that no good thing do you hold from those who walk uprightly before you. So we cast down every demonic attack of rebellion. Yes. We declare she is in rebellion. Name. We declare, God, that she is one who will walk as a child, was with your father in obedience. Yes. Hallelujah. For you have not desired sacrifice, you desire obedience. So we thank you, Father God, that she will walk in obedience in Jesus' name. And we thank you, Lord, for Christina, God. We just lift her up to you, Father God. We ask you just to close her in the mind of Christ. We thank you, Lord, that you will give her your perspective on the things that you have for her to do. And I thank you, Lord, that she will be one who remains in humility as you open the door and continue to elevate her. I see doors opening quickly for you, Christina. And I see how you're the double shake it. I just see you, you know, just stand before the Lord. Like he is so pleased with the submission of your heart, with your seeking of him and his wisdom.
you can see to go through the go through these doors, just remember to stay humble and continue to let you stay humble even as he elevates you, because the way up is truly down. Hallelujah. So she is going to remain one who is diligently seeking you, even as you put her in rooms with great people and you give her the wisdom of God, that she is going to continually seek you, God, for your word is truth. Truth shall set people free. We thank you, Lord, for the word of truth that she will speak and for the freedom that is going to come as a result of that. Hallelujah. Yes. And Paige, the Lord calls you into rest. The Lord calls you into stillness. It's the still small voice, not by power, not by might, but by my spirit, says God. The things that you need to happen and change in not just your mind, but like in your emotional health is going to come with stillness. So the Lord says, come to me, for he is the shepherd that leads you to the green pastures. He is the shepherd that leads you to the still water. So Lord, we just ask you, Lord, to lead your daughter to the still waters. We thank you, Lord, for a revelation of stillness. And we thank you, Holy Spirit, that you are, the Holy Spirit is not a loud voice. He's a very small, still voice. Yes. But intentional on hearing him. And so the Lord is calling you into that space. For you are just, even like the sister said, you are a human being and not a human doing. Okay. You're gonna be a human being. That's be before him. And I thank you, Father God, that you're going to give her just such a revelation of, I just feel God's love for you, his heart for you. For sure you are one of you're productive. The Lord can trust you with many assignments, but you've got to be able to hear him clearly so that you can execute what it is that he is telling you to do. And he even calls you even into your study life. And so not have it be like a thing on a to-do list, but it's truly a time where you are learning him. So it's almost like just go into your study and with your Bible study time with the objective of knowing a new thing about Jesus. Like, what else can I learn about you? Hallelujah. Yeah. So Lord, we thank you, Lord, that you desire to show your daughter more of you. We thank you, Father God, that she's going to come and leave this time, God, with a deeper revelation of who you are. Hallelujah. And how she might reflect you in the earth realm. Father, we thank you for Paris.
Thank you for her journey.
Hallelujah. We thank you for her journey. I see a winding road, and I see the Lord going before you and making the crooked places straight.
Yes, Lord. Endure much,
but the Lord is calling you into it's almost like a graduation. It's like you have to, like the Hebrew boys, this is the scripture that I'm seeing, like the Hebrew boys, they went through fire, but when they came out of the fire, they didn't smell like smoke. They didn't look like they had been in the fire. And so the Lord is calling you to just become into an awareness that, like, he does not want you to carry things from your past. He does not want you to carry burdens, even in your heart, even memories. Like, we come against memory recall in the name of Jesus, that you have endured. In the name of Jesus, I just speak peace over your mind. And I just pray, Father, that you will begin to let her see herself and her future the way that you see her. And even though dynamics in your relationships changing, the roles and is changing in some of your relationships, Lord, and we thank you, God, for what you have for Ferris to do. There's much work to do. I see a lot of things in your hand. I see books and like stacks of papers, and I don't know what this is, but it's like a lot. You've got a lot of different things, and the Lord is bringing you into order so that you will order the things that he has for you to do. And he's even going to release the strategy of what to do first and what to do next, because you seem overwhelmed. I just see you being like kind of overwhelmed with the variety of things that you feel like you should be doing. So just go to the Father and ask him, God, give me the strategy for today. So the word says today has enough trouble in it. Tomorrow will take care of itself. So God, we thank you, Lord, that you bring Paris into an awareness, God, that she can trust you for a strategy for the day. Hallelujah. Hallelujah. So we give you glory and honor, God, for your daughters here. And just thank you, Lord, for the wisdom that you are releasing on tonight. Father, Okay, that was it. I don't know if he's going to speak to somebody else, but we thank you, Father God, for your word. We thank you for your love, and we thank you for your truth. I pray that these young ladies will take these words before you and pray over the words that you release to them. And I pray for just strategy and increase in Jesus' name. Amen.
Amen.
Amen. Bless God.
Beautiful. You guys are awesome. The Lord met us here. Okay. Okay. So then next Sunday, we can go back to normal. So that will be 11 o'clock Central. And I'll share the link. I love you guys.
Love you.
I love you guys.
Bye.
All right. Bye.